I've just met somebody in Canada who came from India to Canada on a sports visa. They came as a cricketer to Canada. And then he was in the Canadian national team. And then once he was fielding and he fell on his shoulder and he had an injury. And that ended his cricket career. And as he left his country and come here. And that was the time somehow he was so depressed. But he met devotees, got a Bhagavad Gita. And that's how he understood. I thought I'm a cricketer. And now I can't be a cricketer. Then who am I? Then he understood, actually, I'm a soul. So then that gave him such relief. And now he's become a business person and he travels across the world. And he's a very wonderful devotee speaker and a leader of a community there. So the point is that sometimes the whole identity which we have formed might come crumbling down. So like a tsunami coming on the surface of the ocean. So if we are on the surface, we will be swept away. If we identify with our functional roles alone, if we identify that this is my functional identity and this is who I am, and tomorrow we can't do that, then we'll be destroyed. But if we do, we go deep in, understand, yes, this is my functional identity. Yes, I am a doctor, I am an engineer, but that is only a part of who I am. Below all these, I am a soul. So understanding our functional identity gives us stability. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that yam hi navyatayante te purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram somrutatvaya kalpate. So yam hi navyatayante te navyatayante te, you will not be disturbed. Why? Because you will understand that you are a soul. Purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram. Happiness and distress will come. Somrutatvaya kalpate. If you understand you are a soul, then, and you act accordingly, you will rise to the spiritual level of understanding. And then Krishna gives various frames of analysis to explain how actually we are souls. So he says that avinashi tu tadviddhi yena sarvamidam tatam vinasham avyayasyasya na kashchit kartum arhati. There is something which pervades the whole body, and that is consciousness. Now, as soon as you talk about something like the soul, people start, we may get the question, hey, is this scientific? Is that scientific? Now, yes, it's a good question to ask, but science is a particular way of looking at the world, and science is the study of matter. The Bhagavad Gita is the study of what matters. Science is the study of matter. Okay, how do various material things interact with each other? Okay, this Newton saw that fruit falling. Some people say it fell in front of him, some people say it fell on him. And then, most people would just have picked up the fruit and eaten it and gone their way. But Newton asked, hey, what made this fruit fall? And then he came up with gravity. So it's a study of matter. And science is phenomenally effective in the study of matter. But the study of what matters, what is really important in life, that science doesn't tell us. Science is not moral, it is not immoral, it is amoral. Amoral means science can tell if some young boy is there and he has a grandmother who has a big mansion which she has given as inheritance to him. Now he knows science by studying chemistry, he can know that if I put arsenic in my grandmother's breakfast, I can get the inheritance faster. But should I do that or not do that? That science doesn't tell. Now this is not a deficiency of science, because science doesn't study that. Now Einstein said that we can talk about the ethical foundation of science, but we can't talk about a scientific foundation of ethics. So ethics is something which it's very important for us to know what to do and what not to do. But how do we know that? We know that not by any scientifically measurable parameter. what is to be done? Science can tell us, if you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. But the study of what matters, that is outside the domain of science. Say, nowadays, I recently gave a seminar on overcoming fear. So I did a study of different fears that people have had across different centuries. So what are the top 10 fears in the 18th century, 19th century, 20th century, 21st century? So in the 21st century, two fears have been added in the top 10 list. One is the fear of terrorists. And the second is the fear of rejection. Rejection. We form a relationship with someone and that person just rejects us and goes away. So now, that is a great, great fear when we enter into a relationship. Is other person, does the other person really care for us? Now suppose a boy proposes to a girl, you know, I love you, please marry me. Now the girl can't take out a love-o-meter, let me put it on your heart, to see, do you really love me? Now no matter how much scientific advancement we make, we cannot quantify love. This doesn't mean it is not real. Science studies mathematical measurable parameters. And it studies material interactions and material phenomena, but there is much that is beyond the arena of science. So is there scientific evidence for the soul? Or we can say that we can make inferences about it. But there is physical matter, there is subtle matter, and there is spirit. So physical matter is primarily what science studies. Subtle matter is what is beyond science. And spirit is entirely beyond science. So the soul is not against science. The soul is above science. Now, there is scientific evidence in the sense that where does consciousness come from? This is very difficult for people to understand. For scientists to understand. I have written a book on reincarnation. And in that book, I studied about, on the 125th anniversary of the Science magazine, they had 125 questions whose answer science doesn't have. The second question there was, where does consciousness come from? The second most unanswered question. The first unanswered question was, where does the universe come from? So where does universe come from and where does our consciousness come from? These are questions which are very difficult to answer. So now the Bhagavad Gita gives us a possible answer. It says, consciousness comes from the soul. And if it comes from the soul, what is the practical implication of that? So Krishna gives characteristics of the soul. He says, achedyoyam adhayoyam akledyoshoshevacha nitya sarvagata sthanur achaloyam sanatanaha. It's like if we have a particular object, we might want to know about its physics and chemistry. Krishna says, this cannot be dissolved. This cannot be burned. This cannot be withered. This is indestructible. And now understanding ourselves as the soul gives us an internal level of security that no amount of financial security, social security, any kind of insurance can provide us. Because we understand as a soul, I am indestructible. So this is the central message that Krishna gives. Shift your identity. Understand that you are neither a Kshatriya nor you are a Kurunandana. You are first and foremost a Atma, a soul. And as a soul, decide what is your function. So there Krishna says that Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityur Dhruvam janma mrutasya cha, that everybody is going to die. And after everybody dies, they're going to be born again.